Here we go. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome in this session where we will see how you can make your Kubernetes cluster survive when you have no internet access. I'm Christophe Geoffrey. I'm a staff solution architect at Nutanix. We are making some cloud enterprise platform, and I'm part of the product management team. I work with product manager and engineering to push the cloud native strategy inside Nutanix. The goal of this session today is to share with you a lot of experience I have with user, customer we see every week, every month, and specifically on these specific use cases where when you want to use Kubernetes in enterprise, there'll be some issue when you need to share access on internet and so on. The goal of this presentation is to give you a lot of feedback about how it works internally. Sometimes you don't see all this part, but the goal is to share it a little bit with you and also to share with you some best practices, some additional tools we can use to help in this case. So let's start by the beginning. I'm pretty sure almost everybody in this room already launched containers. I'm pretty sure. Sometimes that's pretty fast. You don't see this kind of picture. There is some progress bar where you see some images are downloaded. Usually you just see the end. The images are downloaded inside your laptop. This is if you use Docker. Same if you are using Kubernetes, you make a kubectl create deployment with an image. And in this case, you don't see it. Just the result, this is created. But if you look the event behind, there is a specific line there we'll see this image, this container was successfully pulled. The main idea here is every time usually you try, let's click to fast. Every time you try to get something with Docker, with Containerd, with your runtime, with Kubernetes, these images are coming from internet. There is plenty of registry inside internet, and sometimes you see the name, you know Docker Hub, maybe it was the initial registry, but there is plenty of registry at Google, at Amazon, at Azure, where there is plenty of interesting containers. And every time you make a basic command to deploy a container, to deploy a pod, you specify an image, and this image is coming from outside. So you will say me, what is the problem? Usually, almost everybody have a great bandwidth at home, for example. You have a fiber connection that's pretty fast. You download your image, there is no issue, no problem. But in enterprise, that's a little bit different. Plenty of you already see this message, error image pull. That's something pretty frequent, and specifically when we try to use Kubernetes inside an enterprise network, inside an enterprise context, that's something which is pretty recurrent. I have shared the kind of use cases we can meet in three different parts. The first one is when you meet some limited network. This is for me the basic and the common security posture you can find inside a normal enterprise, I will say, because if you don't have some security rules, some filtering inside your network, and if you try to make a serious business, I think you need to try to think a little bit because security today is a real issue. And there is people inside your company around you, we are trying to enforce this security. So they are putting some firewall in place, they are making filtering based on the destination you try to achieve. They're making some flow inspection, providing some additional tools to help to go outside, but also to protect the enterprise, some proxy, some user authentication. They are creating some DMZ where you need to put your Kubernetes cluster. Everything has one goal. This is the security, but also this kind of stuff is bringing issue because, as I said before, a default Kubernetes installation needs to retrieve some stuff outside of your own network, and these rules, this posture is causing issue. The first thing you need to do, that's basic rules, I agree with you, but just try first to identify what you need to get outside. Sometimes that's just to read a simple documentation where you will see a list of targets you need to open. So just talk with the network team, with the security team to open this target. Just one thing, be careful about this documentation because pretty often I see documentation are not up to date, even ours sometimes are not up to date because rules are changing, destinations are not the same. Maybe the backend are also changing. Initially, they are providing the registry at a specific name, but after that, they make a redirection and are using some different DNS names, so it can cause some issue. Sometimes that's better to go to the root. depending on the tools you plan to use to deploy your Kubernetes distribution, sometimes they are providing some command line interface to get the image you need to retrieve to install the product. I give two examples here, one with kubeadm, which is the basic default Kubernetes tool to install a Kubernetes distribution, and the second one with Cluster API, who becomes the main framework to automatically deploy some Kubernetes cluster. Every time you see there is basic command, get config, image list, stuff like that, to retrieve the list of image you need to get to be able to install this Kubernetes distribution. So use this tool, that's pretty useful. And if this is not enough, if you have some issue, don't hesitate also to talk with the guys from the security, from the networking, to retrieve the logs, because in the logs you will see clearly, I try to get this image, and there is an issue, the port is not open, there is no connection available. That's the main issue you can meet. The second one is when the network team, the security team, try to force you to use a proxy. That's something pretty often with mandatory to go outside of an enterprise network. And in this case, it needs a little bit more work inside your cluster. First, you need to configure this proxy at your container runtime level. The container runtime, this is the process we are managing the life cycle of your containers. And this is the process who go outside to retrieve the images. This process needs to be configured. Usually, there is some environment variables to set. I put the three main ones here. This is HTTP proxy, HTTPS proxy, and no proxy. And these variables need to be given to the container runtime. If you are using some specific additional tools to install your Kubernetes cluster, read the doc, because sometimes there is some additional method to pass the proxy information. But if you are just using the basic Kubernetes tools, like kubeadm or cluster.setl, you need to pass this information and you need to set it at the container D level. That's something pretty simple. Usually, this is a process called systemd. We are launching container D. You just need to create what we call a drop-in. So you need to make an additional file. I put the name of the file here. This is an example, but you need to put it inside this specific path. You need to put inside the file the three environment variables and the value of this environment variable you want to set. And after that, you just reload systemd configuration and you reload your container D daemon. And if you ask a status about container D, you will see there is a specific line where you will see here, where is my mouse? I miss it, drop in here, and you will see they are loading multiple dropping and you need to find the one you created before. For example, http-proxy here. This is the file I just configured here. So that's important because this change allows the container runtime to use the proxy to get the image outside. But this is only the beginning, because now, that's okay, you just set your runtime is able to download images, but what about your apps? By default, all the apps you plan to run inside your Kubernetes cluster are not able to access to internet because they don't know how to use and where the proxy is. You need to do almost the same, because each app who need to have access to internet need to be configured to use this proxy. Usually, the majority of Unix apps are using the same logic with environment variable. I say the majority because sometimes some product ask you to configure some additional config file. Go back to the doc in this case, but usually, the environment variable is something which is supported by plenty of different apps. Sometimes, just be careful, sometimes that's not an uppercase HTTP or HTTPS proxy, sometimes this is lowercase, so be careful, you can have this kind of issue. But the idea is to configure this kind of environment variable at the container level, at the pod level, in case of Kubernetes. So you will say me, that's pretty simple. I need to edit my manifest file, add some environment variable with the same value I have put inside the runtime, and that's okay. But the issue here is we are using containers, we are using Kubernetes. The goal of Kubernetes is to orchestrate a lot of containers. And in this case, if you need to do that for 100, 1,000, 10 of thousands of containers, it becomes pretty difficult. And specifically, if you are a lot of pods we are creating and disappearing and maybe created by some external process like an operator or like some CI/CD chain, that's something will become pretty difficult. Some advice. There is a tool I like a lot, which is called Kiverno. I don't know if you know these tools. This is a policy engine for Kubernetes. That's a pretty nice tool who allow to create some policies, and these policies is able to validate, mutate, generate, and clean up some Kubernetes resources. This is something we are directly integrated inside the API server through a webhook mechanism, and it intercepts directly during the creation time of your request. For example, you ask to create a deployment. Automatically, they will get the deployment request, and you can apply this policy on this request. That's something we are pretty simple to install. There is an mChart, three commands. You have the example here. You can install Kiverno pretty easily. And after that, the goal in my case, remember, we want to set proxy for our POIs. The goal is to create a policy to automatically set this proxy for all the apps. So the policy, I put it here. This is an example. That's pretty simple. Inside the policy, this is a custom resource for Kubernetes, a Kiverno custom resource in this case. There is two main parts. The first one with here, this is the target. Which resources we want to do something on it. In this case, we want to target the pods. Easy. And after that, what we do on this pod, there is an action called mutate. In this case, we will mutate on the fly the pod we will be deployed inside the Kubernetes cluster. Here, easy, I make a patch of all the containers, and I will just add my env variable inside this policy. And after that, every time I will create a new pod without touching anything, these three env variables will be added directly inside my pod. And this is totally dynamic. We can improve a little bit this approach. Imagine you don't want all your apps use the proxy because there is plenty of apps we are here only to provide some internal services. You can add a specific selector inside the target part where you will say, okay, I want to make this mutation, but only for the pod. We have a specific label in this case, proxy equal inject. That's an example. You can adapt the policy as you want, but this is something pretty agile. Kiverno, you can create your own policy to adapt the behavior of the policy to what you want to achieve exactly. The second use cases we can see in enterprise network is when your network are fully isolated. This is a high security posture you can find, clearly, no internet access at all. Usually, this kind of company go even deeper. For example, they allow you to use some bastion only to connect to the Kubernetes cluster. You don't make direct Kubernetes cluster connection. For example, when you use your Kubernetes cluster, you are recorded, so you don't need to make some weird stuff because there is a proof that this is you, we are making stuff. So this is clearly an high security posture. And in this case, using Kubernetes can become pretty more difficult. The first thing is auto-install it. Usually, depending on the tools you are using to install it, there is some specific method to target this kind of environment. So don't hesitate, look the docs of the tools you are installing, and there is some keyword to search. We are talking a lot of air gap or no internet connection install method. That's something we can find in a lot of documentation. But if we go a little bit deeper to see how it works exactly. The idea, you need to first identify every containers, every images, every artifact you need to get to be able to install your Kubernetes cluster. After that, you need to pre-pool these items to store it locally. And after that, the configuration of the tools who deploy the Kubernetes cluster have usually some flags to set to say, okay, I don't want to use the live external registry or the live external repository, but I want to use my internal repository where I have make a copy of all my artifacts I need to deploy my cluster. So in this case, the first thing you need to install locally is a container registry because the majority of artifacts you need to copy locally to deploy your cluster is container images. And in this case, you need a local registry. We are lucky. If you look the CNCF landscape, there is plenty of choice. I put a quick capture on the registry choice of the landscape on this slide. There is a lot of choice, so there is a different choice for different people. But when you need to choose your registry, keep in mind that depending on the registry you choose, you can have some specific registry feature who will help you in this kind of situation where you have no internet access or difficult internet access. For example, you can target a registry with Able to make some replication between different registries, for example, to get automatically image from outside and put it inside your local registry. The security part can be also interesting to be able to scan the image you get from outside and allow to retrieve it internally only if the scan is okay, for example, no critical or ICV. This is the kind of feature you can find in the registry. And also the entire image lifecycle, the security, the way they distribute the image. There is plenty of optimization you can find in some registry. Globally, if we have the luck that your registry, just the registry, not the Kubernetes cluster, but just the registry have access to internet, you can imagine, if your registry is able to do that, to set some replication rules directly inside the registry. I give an example here with Arbor. We can say, okay, I want to make a copy of all these images or maybe all of this external registry of subpart of the registry inside my local one. It helps you to not track everything with externally updated and to retrieve it internally. That's a good way to do, but that's not always possible. If you are in a true air gap situation, there is no access. Your local registry is not able to access externally. So in this case, you need to make a two-step process. You need to have a first desktop or laptop who have internet access, and in this case, you need to retrieve your images. And after that, you need to put your images maybe on a drive, on a USB key, move it to a second laptop who have access internally, and maybe you need to validate your images for the security posture before, and after that, you push it inside your internal registry. To do that, there is some tools we can help. There is one I advise a lot to people. This is Scopeo. Scopeo, this is like a Swiss Army knife when you need to work with containers and registries. That's a pretty easy to use tool. You install it with your basic package manager, whatever you are using, Linux, macOS, Windows, there is a version for that. And after that, you can use some basic command. I put the example, the sync command, for example, in Scopeo, allow you to get a copy of some external images, make a local archive. After that, you take the archive, you move it to the second laptop, or you move the laptop to the second place, to the second network, and you make a reverse sync. Globally, you take the local archive and you push it inside the local registry. So that's allow you to optimize the way you copy the image versus making a Docker pull, Docker push, Docker pull, Docker push for every image. It becomes pretty complicated. Once you have done that, imagine your Kubernetes cluster is already deployed, you have the images inside your local registry, you need to use it. So a little bit like the proxy, the easy way is to change your manifest. Okay, there is an image path in the manifest, you just replace the public reference inside the image path, and you put your local registry with the path of your image. One more time, if you have just few manifests to change, that's easy, but in a true agile environment with plenty of containers and plenty of agile methods we are deploying containers, that's difficult. Depending on the way you are installing apps, for example, in Kubernetes, there is Helm. Helm is used a lot to deploy apps. You can look inside your Helm chart sometime, and pretty often there is some way inside the value files, inside the configuration of the chart itself, where you can change the path target of your image. If you have this case, that's easy. I just give the example here with Kiverno. For example, imagine you want to install Kiverno with images stored inside your local registry. There is some value you can set, like image.repository, initimage.repository, cleanupcontroller.image.repository, and in every of these values, you put your local repository. Not every Helm chart is providing this kind of feature, and even if they provide it, there is not a default method to do that, so the name of the value can change, it can be some issue, so that's something pretty difficult. One more time, we can think to use Kiverno and wrote a second policy to adapt automatically your image path inside your pod. So the example here is a little bit the same. You have always the same target, the pods, and you have some mutate action where we say, okay, here I use a regex. I take everything before the first slash inside my images, and I put my local registry. It will also depend on the registry you are using, because depending on the registry, there is different way to develop the exact path of your image, but you can adapt these rules based on your need. And take care, I split the policy a little bit because you need to do that for the containers, but also for the init containers. That's the way. There is another one which is also pretty useful. You have the ability to configure the container runtime directly to make this kind of replacement. With containerd, which is pretty common in many of Kubernetes distribution, you have the ability to create some additional configuration file. I give an example here. You need to set your main configuration file to use a specific config path directory. This is a dynamic one. And after that, you create some file like this host.toml file, and you put it in some folder. There is a default folder, and it will be a default rules to set all the registry requests, or you can also make a specific folder for each registry namespace. A registry namespace, globally, this is the name of the namespaces. So in my example, I put a quay.io if I want to intercept only the call to the quay.io and replace my local registry only in this case. And after that, you create the host.toml file inside the right folder, and you have a specific syntax, you will see it here, where you define which registry, the local one, you want to use. You can adapt the path, go deeper inside your own local registry. There is plenty of stuff you can look inside the documentation to adapt the way the replacement will be made. But the real interest with this point, when you set the container runtime with this feature, there is no more anything to do inside your pods, inside your LAML, inside your manifest, that's automatically translated at the runtime level. For people who are using OpenShift, for example, there is exactly the same kind of feature, the ability to set the runtime, Cryo in this case, to replace on the fly also the images. The last case is also a case that's not a fully isolated or limited network, but that's a specific case who also brings some issue when you want to deploy some Kubernetes clusters. This is a constrained network case. Because, and this is something with specific to the edge scenario, when you have some issue with the bandwidth, when you have some issue because there is a lot of latency, or maybe some packet loss, the bandwidth is pretty low, or just because sometimes if you are using some pretty highly costly line, for example, using satellite or this kind of stuff, that's a case where you want also to optimize the way the Kubernetes cluster is working. An example is to reuse what we just see about the isolated network approach, because the fact to deploy a local registry to make some automatic image replication is useful when we are in this kind of edge scenario, because imagine you have local registry at the edge level. If you have multiple Kubernetes clusters at the edge level, we need to retrieve this image. They retrieve it directly inside the local registry, and you can plan the local registry to automatically replicate the image at certain time, or maybe automatically when there is some new image available. So there is plenty of optimization you can do at this level. And the objective in this case is just always have the needed image inside your edge, inside your remote location. But there is one issue with this approach. This is when you want to launch a new apps. Imagine inside the central place, the developer creates a new apps, and if you want to push it on the fly on the remote site, it will take time, because if your image starts to be a little bit big, I know the containers, we try to keep it small, but that's not always a situation. I see some customers, some people with containers making multiple gigabits, for example, in size. And in this case, it causes some issue. There is the last tools I want to share with you. There is the ability to make some image streaming at the container runtime level. And there is some project to do that, and the more common one is the StarGZ project. This is an external snapshotter you can set directly inside your runtime. So globally, it replaces a part of your runtime, and specifically the part we are managing the images by this specific component. And the idea here is that the runtime is able to start container even before they fully download, they fully pull the images. So that's pretty useful, because you can imagine new scenario, and specifically when you have very big containers. I even see some customer, we have customer around 100 gigabytes, so that's pretty big. In this case, they will make some streaming, and they will start to get the first part of the container, and after that, on demand, depending on the file you want to access on the container, they can continue to download it on the fly. This kind of project is not too much complex to install. Just to give you an example, you need to install inside each of your hosts the StartGZ snapshotter component, of course, and you need, one more time, to reconfigure Containerd. Globally, there is two main parts to configure. I give the example here. That's pretty easy to do. You can put it inside your host template, for example. And the last step, you need to optimize your images because you can't use the default images from the public registry because the images need to be optimized to be used by the eStartGZ snapshotter. In this case, they just rethink a little bit how the image it built, making some layer to allow you to distribute it independently. In this case, there is multiple ways to work. If this is your own container, at the build time, there is some option you can use to optimize on the fly the container. But this is not yours. That's sometimes more difficult, but we are lucky. There is some extension who exists for some registry, and this extension is able on the fly when you pull when you push an image inside the registry to take it, optimize it, and create a second version of the images inside the registry with a different tag, for example. And after that, the only thing you have to do is to consume these new images. Just to finish, to give you a quick example, I pull twice the same images. Globally, this is the one I push in my local registry, the first one, and you see I make some restriction of my network, so it takes 4 minutes to download. And the same image will be optimized automatically by my registry extension, take only 2 seconds before they start the container. For sure, in 2 seconds, you don't have the entire image, but you have all the basic parts needed to be able to start it. And after that, they will continue to download it. So you will have some latency at the beginning based on the network speed, but it allows you to don't block you when you launch the containers. So if we need to conclude, there is a lot of situations where the network access is difficult, or même sometimes is impossible. But this is not a calamity. As we see, there is multiple ways to solve it. Globally, if you have basic posture, limited network, be careful about the rules, talk with your network team. You can use the proxy very easily if you take the right tools and the right approach. If your team is implementing a real security approach with a strong RGAP process, there is also some way to solve it. Local registry, automatic replication, or maybe some two-step replication with tools like Scopeo. We have seen with Kiverno, we can help you a lot to reduce the number of processes you need to do inside the Kubernetes cluster to manage the proxy or to manage the change of registry. There is plenty of way to solve it. Just please find the one who catch the best with you. And same for the constrained network. You can also reuse the isolated network approach or also start to use streaming. The streaming approach is something pretty new, but that's, we see more and more people using it, and the progress is really permanent on this part. So don't hesitate to test it, at least, and to see how it works. Inside the deck, I put a link on all the projects I share with you inside this presentation. You can get it by scanning this QR code. You have a direct access to the PDF of the deck, and you also have the ability to ask questions or also to give some feedback about the session. So I expect you like it, and it will be useful for you, and I will say a big thank you, and if you have any questions, please. Some question, yes?
So that would work well. And I have a question. Say, for example, we are creating a Kubernetes cluster, and now I'm trying to pull, let's say, a manifest file from the outside internet to, say, set up CNI.
Yeah.
So in that case, how do we, so for images, we are setting up the local images, image registry. Manifest, what do you recommend?
Usually, it depends. Yeah, with the micro again. Okay, the main question is about how we manage the pool of the manifest himself. Globally, it depends how you install your application. There is some few examples, Helm chart, but for the CNI, that's not the case. Usually, CNI, it depends of the CNI, because, for example, a lot of people are using Cilium. Cilium have an Helm chart. I believe you are from VMware. So from Entrea, I don't know if you have an Helm chart or not, but in this case, the easy way is maybe to create your own Helm chart based on the YAML your sources you are able to download externally, and you can put this Helm chart directly inside the registry, because Helm chart also today is able to be stored inside an OCI compatible registry. So I think this is the best way to do that. Create your...
There is the manifest.
Yeah, exactly. Make an Helm chart and put it inside the registry.
Okay.